أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمد عبده ورسوله. والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه وأجمعين. We seek refuge with Allah from the rejected from Satan, with Allah from the merciful benefactor, the merciful redeemer. All praise is due to Allah alone. He has no partners. We openly bear witness that there is nothing worthy of worship except Allah alone, and we bear witness that Muhammad is his messenger. We ask that the prayers and the peace be upon Muhammad, upon his family, and upon us all. I greet you with the peace and blessings of As-Salaam Alaikum. This is Aneesah Dawan from Little Rock, Arkansas, and we are on this morning with Study Al-Islam as we are still within our ascension as believers through the Prophet's ascension, inshallah. We are on level 6, so we are actually very, very close to the end of this ascension, and we pray that as we have been ascending with the information that you all have been able to apply that in your own development and consciousness, and that you are at a much higher level of conscious state. It definitely is a practice. And today, that's actually what we will do, some of. So, in line with some of what Imam Tariq did last week, we want to look at, of course, some of that. But we want to look at it in a very much application situation. So a lot of what the Imam Sharaib provided, especially those of you who study logic, right, just the structure of logic, how it's delivered in an academic setting, and then just how it is to be understood, because you utilize logic, right? You're doing the process of what you talked about. So we want to, in doing that process, we actually want to walk through some of that and see how that looks in some recent conversations that I've had with people and talking about the ascension of Muhammad the Prophet, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That it's sometimes there is a bit of a disconnect in the applicability of this ascension in your own conscious thinking. Ascension that we're looking at according to Imam W. Muhammad Safir and his understanding in receiving inspiration from Allah, from Quran, and then looking at the Prophet's lives and then the Prophets themselves, their lives, and what they represented, that it's saying that this should be your consciousness that is ascending. It should be your whole being should be ascending. With every piece of this information that you're receiving, you should be able to literally see it. So when you're not able to see it, that means, one, we're not understanding it properly, or we've missed a portion of that ascension process. We've missed something inside of that process and that disconnect. But this thing is happening. It's currently happening to you, even if you're not completely aware of it, it's happening. The more conscious you become of it, is the only way that you're actually going to be able to reach the higher levels, because it's talking about consciousness. If you're not conscious of it, then it's defeating the purpose, right? So that's what we want to deal with today. So we're in level 6, which is Moses, and Moses has a few different terms, and we want to deal with some of those terms inside of Imam W.D. Muhammad's tafsir that he's represented Moses as, and even in Quran. When you think about Moses and what he has done in his life and what it represents, then you're going to see all of these different pieces inside of Musa alayhi salam. So, one, in this, I want us to understand this as Moses as a liberator of logic, okay? So, in essence, what I want to make sure I portray today is that Moses is a liberator of logic. When Imam Sharaib talked about Musa alayhi salam, and he gave us the correlation of Musa and his development at level 5 being correlated to the ayats in Quran given in Surah 23 al-Mu'minun, where Allah is talking about the development of the human life. So the development of the material human life can be juxtaposed, right? It can be set consider them side by side, the development of the material life with the development of the conscious life, the mind of the human being. So this is where Imam Muhammad gave us the development of the human life, when it, which is given in Quran, as it's given in Quran in Surah 23, Ayat 14, I believe. So it's talking about the development of that life given in seven levels, right? The sixth level is when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that the bones are clothed with flesh, okay? So then if you take that level, you go up to the human being, and at that level is where you have Moses at the sixth. And then at the seven is where Allah says, and then from that I created another creation, which is where Abraham will be, which is what we'll discuss in our next segment. So here in Moses, he's going to be set right on side of this idea that the bones are clothed with flesh. So we understood that the bones being representative of Aaron, which was on the level right below Moses on the fifth level, and knowing that Aaron and his logic is going to be based out of culture. So in order for us to really keep seeing this, we have to go in between all the levels, right? And then even coming from the beginning and then build us up. So this is where we are. Aaron, we understand him to be a logic that was based in culture. We also understand Aaron to be representative of the five senses, okay? So the culture that you developed was based in your five senses, right? And it evolved into a logic. Okay, this is all of this is in the five. So let's take us up from the beginning. So if I say we have Adam, alayhi salam, which is at one, and this is your material reality. Okay, this is all in your material reality. This is what he's establishing. And when you come into this world just as a material being, your thinking, your conscious thinking, is just based in material. That's, you're like, hey, this is what it is. It's all in material. So you have to see yourself in that. Look at your own life and look at how you initially focus on a material existence. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter what you have going on. Your first reality, even for the baby is concerned with this material reality. Hey, I'm hungry. I need some food. You know, hey, I'm thirsty. I need something to drink. Where's my mother? Right? I need that nourishment. It's all material. It's very much a material reality. Well, inside of the material, then you have a spiritual reality where you get Jesus and John on that next level, and the spirit comes in to direct the material reality, right? And so we know this for our own development is that, yeah, you have a material reality, but then you have to recognize, right, be aware of, oh, wait, you know, my material is actually being driven by my spiritual. Like, I thought, you know, and this is the child. The child, in their development, they're thinking material, not even understanding that really, when they move in their development, that their spirit is actually being driven. It's driving their material reality. So you come into that understanding, right? Oh, okay, I have a spirit, right? It's not just all material. I actually have a spirit that's moving this body around. This is all simple, right? This is the basic as you develop. Then you come into that third level of Joseph, and now it's an intuition. Okay? So you're this intuitive nature that you gain from being conscious of both your material and your spiritual reality, it didn't require any knowledge from you, right? This is that intuition. It's that natural movement. It's that inspiration from Allah, right? You don't have to have any knowledge, right? Allah will inspire you, and you're like, oh man, I was inspired to do this, and you didn't have any knowledge. You could do this with your health, right? If you can be feeling bad. You're not a doctor, right? You're not a nurse. You don't have any medical degrees. You can be feeling bad, and Allah will inspire you to do something in order to make you feel better. And you'll do it. You'll say, okay, man, Allah, you say, I do this. And you'll do it, and you'll start to feel better. But that wasn't based on knowledge. That wasn't based on this great understanding. That was based on your material and your spiritual coming together, and Allah provided you, right, an inspiration. Well, when you get that inspiration, it drives you to then do what? Study the thing that Allah drove you to. So you say, okay, Allah, he inspired me to do this, go and get this piece of medicine, this thing, and I got this thing, and it made me feel better. So guess what you do now? You start to look at this thing. This is what children do, right? If you ever dealt with a child, and they're driven, they get this inspiration to do this thing, that's the first thing, they start looking at the thing. Yeah, it's like, let me study this thing. Well, now you will study your inspiration. Studying is the action, the movement, right, that will produce from the study and for, this is what produces this culture. This is what produces this logic, okay? So you're inspired, you study it. The study of what you were inspired to look at then develops in you a culture and a logic. And when you're saying a culture is your process of logic, okay? Culture is your process. Right now, you hear people when they talk about the culture of the United States, right? Well, the culture is our logic. It's how we are deriving our movement, how we come to them. So if you look at right now the logic around the culture in the United States around just what you wear, okay? So as we move about and we're interacting with our environment, and understand that the fifth level of Aaron, that is the five senses. So we're moving about in our society, and we're interacting with things, we're touching all this material world, we're interacting with it, and we're from our inspiration, we're looking at certain things and we studied it, and then we start to develop a logic around it. We're saying, oh man, I see that this, when I put this particular dress on, that the people responded in this way or this happened. So the logic tells me that, I mean, my logic from interacting is telling me that, oh, this is good, right? So right now, as far as our dress in our society, is that you can go around and the logic is telling the human beings that we shouldn't discriminate on people because of how they look. This is what the logic will tell you, right? So let's utilize some of what Aneesh said and how you structure your logic, right? How the logic operates. So we're around in the society, and as we're interacting with each other, that we have cultural dresses, right? We saw that men and women were different. So we said, oh, the women, you know, they wear this and the men wear this. And you're like, okay, that's good. You know, this is good. Then as we evolve, we start seeing that people who are dressed in this fashion, that people are treating them a certain way, and then people are dressed in this fashion, but they're treating them a certain way. And we're saying, oh, man, should we do that? The logic is saying, well, men and women, they both have feelings, they both do this, they both do all these things. They're really similar in how they operate. They both have an intellect, and this is still us evolving, right? As culture, logic is evolving. And you say, well, I don't think I should treat the men and the women different in this respect because, you know, hey, women, they can do these things. They can do these things. Men, they can do these things. You're like, okay, well, no, I shouldn't treat them differently. Well, this is the dress of a man. This is the dress of a woman. Well, if I shouldn't treat them differently, then I shouldn't really have a difference in how they dress either, right? That I should be able to look at how they dress and treat them equally. This is the logic. So let's follow these logical conclusions. Men and women are equal. Okay, so this is going to be one of those logical setups that Aneesh was talking about. That men, women wear dresses. Okay, women wear dresses. Men and women are equal. Men wear dresses. Okay, so it's saying women wear dresses. If men and women are equal, then men can wear dresses. This is, and if you follow that logic, I'm telling you now, the logic of that is both is sad, right? It's a balance.
not what you mean. And I said, Samuel, it depends on how you define dress. It's that he actually can be doing valid sound. But, you know, that's one thing. So, it's looking at this thing that if you look at all of this, that is a valid argument that women's dresses, that men and women are equal. This is where we're evolving to with our logic and our culture in America, is that it states that men and women are equal. This is the drive. You go into Quran, right? Allah says that both the men and the women will have their benefits from Allah for the good that they do. So you have this idea. So, and then when you come now to the end premise, you say, well, men can wear dresses. But what I'm saying is that there is a logic and a culture in our society that is evolving to say that, oh, we have to see the benefit in both men and women on an equal standard. And in doing so, the dress that we've normally given in our culture to one group, we say, hey, if they're equal, we don't want to deny them this dress as well. We want all of the people to be able to dress. So then you come into this big universal work, or this book, monolithic group, we'll say, this monotone group of everybody is looking the same because we don't want to differentiate, meaning we don't want to discriminate, okay? With the logic that they have in the culture, we don't want to discriminate, therefore we don't want to say people can't do this, or you can look any kind of way, and we should still treat you a certain way because we want everyone to have this given right of being treated fairly. Being treated fairly is sound. That's Quran. And this is where Moses comes in, because we have to look at Moses now to say that once you develop this logic, which I've just given you, and if you go to any person in society with that logic, they're going to be like, that's right, that's sound, that's good logic. It's good logic because I don't want to discriminate on people, that I shouldn't just be looking at people's outer dress to determine how I treat them, that yes, men and women can, they can do all these things that are the same, and that they should be treated and seen the same and benefited in the same fashion. This is logical. Well, Moses comes to now, after you develop this logic in this culture that is sincere, that is good, that is, I mean, you're not trying to be wrong, that now, although you've developed that logic, you actually have to now clothe that logic with the flesh. You have to now utilize the rational movement that is to be educated inside of the logic. The logic has to be educated. So Moses, you know Moses, that Moses is a liberator. His flesh, which represents law-driven logic. So you have a logic, but the logic doesn't necessarily have a law to it. It doesn't have a thing that drives it. If you have bones and they're just moving around, those bones just can't move by themselves. Them bones can stand up. If you look at a skeleton, it's standing up. It's all in proportion. Yeah, it's logical, but they have no movement. The logic receives its movement by its flesh. It receives its direction and its order by its flesh. So Moses represents this mission of educator and teacher, and he is specific to the culture. So when you're looking at Moses, you should be seeing Moses as representing the very law that drives how to move your logic. If you don't look at your logic and educate your logic using a law's law, then you will find yourself with a logic that is not consistent with the law, and then therefore that is not productive to the human development. It won't take the human being to the next level of consciousness. You can use the logic, but it will not evolve you. So right now, all of us are sitting with a logic. We have a logic that we have developed through our five senses, through working in the society, and interacting with people, and it seems sound. You're like, hey, man, I see this. These are valid arguments. This is a good logic. But if you have not taken that logic and allows and accepted a lot of law to drive your logic, that logic is taking you off. It's taking you in a direction that does not liberate your thinking. Okay, so here, he says Musa alayhi is a liberator. He is a liberator of logic. I recently went to a conference, and it was a conference of data scientists, and it really was everyone. It was data scientist driven, called Data for Black Lives, and it was data scientist driven, but it was talking about connecting social activists with the data. Okay, so you have all of this information that leads to a certain logical conclusion, but without the social activists to come in now and give the logic a life, it's kind of like, hey, you know, it's just data just sitting there. You can't do anything. Well, this is similar, right? That inside of this data that they had, that it needed a social activist movement to actually put the thing in action. Well, as I'm at this conference and in working with all the different people and talking to them and listening to them, you know, really listening to them, I was listening to some of the logic, and I could see where the logic had combined on it. And this is how it works. That if your logic is solely based in what you have the ability to receive through your five senses, which is Aaron, through your cultural understanding, which is limited, okay? Culture is limited, which is why Moses' liberation in the logic is still specific to a certain set of circumstances. Your culture is you. There's an Arab culture, there's a Chinese culture, there's an American culture, there's an Indonesian culture. All of these cultures are specific to their areas because that's what the culture is driven from. It's driven from your five senses. So if you can imagine, if I'm in Hawaii, right, and I am in Boston, which I was in recently, okay? In Boston, there is going to be a certain dress that goes with Boston in the middle of January and February as it's snowing and you have negative degree weather. You don't, my culture that I'm operating with there in my dress is going to be different than my culture that I'm operating with in Hawaii. Those are specific areas, okay? So my logic of what I can wear, of how I operate, of what I do, is going to be different. Now, that doesn't make either one of them greater than the other, but it does let you know that both of those things are specific, and then if you try to take one, let's say I take the logic of Boston and I try to move it to Hawaii, that, hey, when I wake up, that I'm going to grab my coat, I'm going to do this. I'm going to be in Hawaii poorly dressed, right? I'm going to be out there taking off clothes saying this is not working because your logic was specific to your area, which means that you can't just take that logic and put it somewhere else. So this is where you get the understanding in Quran and you get the reading of Muhammad the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is that you have to see the logic inside of a conscious evolution of the human being. If you take the mere factual logic of Muhammad the Prophet, of his sunnah, of what he did, and you try to transplant it into another person's logic without coming to universal logic, which is what we'll get to with Abraham, then you will oppress a people with a logic and a thinking that is not consistent with where they are, that's not consistent to their circumstance. Okay, so Moses is going to liberate the logic of the thinking of the people. He's going to open their logic up to deal with their circumstance that is not just based in material reality, that has with it the law of Allah. So Allah's law allows you to see things that are broader than just where they are. So when I was dealing with the data scientists and I'm looking at them and talking to them and I was listening to their logic, I said, man, I said, your logic is confined because the only thing that you are dealing with is how you're responding to it materially. If you would allow that logic to be guided by Allah, then you're going to see where your logic was limited, and it's going to free you. It's going to liberate you. Right now, all of us, we have a logic. And we have a logic that if you think on it, that you will say, man, I see where this is valid, but when I allow a law, when I say, okay, Allah, I'm going to use your law when I'm looking at this, and let's look at the dress of the people, which we used earlier. We say that, hey, men and women are equal, right? Women wear dresses. Men and women are equal. Therefore, men wear dresses. If you use a law from flesh, you know, not his little flesh to say that. If you use a law structure, right, meaning a law places the flesh onto the bone, and you allow that to move your logic, then you're going to come and you're going to say, the men and women are equal in their capacity to think, but the physical reality of men and women are different, right? So you have some of your premises, the truth of them, that you would now have to come in and clarify what the truth is, okay? So at first you're just saying men and women are equal. Well, how? In what ways are they equal? Because clearly, when I look at the physical representation of a man, and I look at the physical representation of a woman, that their physical realities are different. That is also a truth. So this logic of this world is giving us all these things, and it's just saying, oh, they're the same. And then when we come back, we say, well, hold on. In what ways are they the same? And then in what ways are they the same will now drive, this is using the Quran, is using the scripture, is using the law that Allah has for the human being in order to correct the logic. And then I'm educating myself now on what I thought my logic was. I said this thing, and now I'm having to peer into it and educate myself using Allah's law to say, oh, now I understand that men and women are equal in their capacities to think. Therefore, when I discuss the logic of how men and women are equal and move in the society, I'm discussing them on rational terms, not just physical terms. Because I see that the physical bodies of both men and women are different. Therefore, now, what I place onto the physical bodies will also be different. Right? Even if you have different dresses and you have different things that people put on the physical bodies of those men and women, if you don't take into account the breast area of both men and women when you're even formulating the clothing, you will have the fit of the thing will be different, right? That it won't fit the same. It won't fit properly because you didn't take into account what the difference was to allow the logic to be found. So this, when you're thinking on Musa alayhi salam, you should be thinking in your own self, let me look at my logic and then let me look at Quran. Let me look at my logic and then let me look at the law that Allah has put into place for the human life. If my logic is not consistent with the law, then my logic it won't allow me to reach a higher level of conscience. I must liberate my logic. I must open it up to say, oh, I see now. I see how now that my logic, although I'm using the logic, that it is based in a culture and it is representative only of a small thing, that now I must go and I look at what Allah says and I say, I got it. Right? I'm utilizing what Allah has given, and I am correcting, I'm elevating my logic. And then you're able to take it to that next level of creation, as it says in 23 and 14, that and when they clothe the bones with the flesh, when they clothe the bones with that education, and they liberated those bones and allowed those bones to have a movement, they were free to move about the country, they were free to roam about the understanding. That only way to do that is to liberate your logic with the light that Allah has for the human being. In its education, it has educated the scriptural understanding, and then it liberates that logic. So I pray that that was good and sound for you. I pray that you can use it, not just hear it, but use it. I'm saying educate your logic. Look at your logic and see where your logic has been based on your own experiences, on your own understanding, just based on your inspiration and working with your five senses, but then you didn't come back and correct that logic and work with that logic based in the education according to Scripture. Use the Scripture to correct your logic and you will find yourself a liberated thinker. Inshallah, we have one more week of Musa alayhi salam, and then we'll be moving on to Ibrahim, and we will see our universal logic, not just the logic based in a specific point, but you have to do them all. You have to do all the steps in order to get there. We pray that your week will be sound and good, and that your logic will be liberated. Assalamu alaikum.